Hey everybody, this is Josh Rundquist here for the 7th episode of the Heavy Debriefings podcast. Whoop whoop. Of course, this is Josh Rundquist along with
The Metal Faerie.
And we are recording this right after AEW All In at Wembley Stadium in London, England has concluded. Mm-hmm. We are currently having the media scrum on in the background just in case there's some kind of altercation that happens.
Fingers crossed.
Yeah, because, you know, sometimes that can be more exciting than the actual wrestling pay-per-view.
Absolutely.
And that's a little bit of a hint that this is going to be a wrestling-heavy show. Of course, it's not going to be all wrestling on the show this week. We got some depressing stuff to talk about, some good stuff to talk about, some positive stuff to talk about. There's a little bit of everything.
Yes.
But since All In just concluded and we paid our $50, we might as well talk about what we saw.
Exactly.
But that'll come in a bit. And the first thing I think we need to talk about is something that has taken the life out of the Metal Faerie and I over the last couple days. Now, I'm going to start this up. Before we get into actually what happened, what was your original idea?
So, if you haven't caught on to this already, we live in an apartment and our kind of office setups, we both work from home, have been kind of in opposite corners of our apartment. And unfortunately for Josh here, he is right under the air conditioner, so he doesn't get any cool air during the summer. It's just kind of hot always over there. And then during the winter, he's right by the heater as well. So he just kind of suffers year round. So I had the idea of me scooching my little setup over a little bit, because I kind of was taking up an entire huge section of our apartment and making some room for Josh.
Yeah, basically a lot of people would consider the dining room area.
Yes.
I would say in an apartment or a flat, depending where you are.
A person's apartment.
Yeah, sure. But the Metal Faerie basically had the whole dining room to herself.
Yes.
To do her work, which we'll not speak of.
No.
But, of course, this is work, too. We can speak about this. But,
sure.
Just the one day she just said, well, why don't we just do this together? Because,
yeah.
A, I'll suffer less. B, she'll suffer less from actually being able to sit on her nice, comfortable chair rather than a green metal chair that has been in my family for at least 3 decades now, which has very little padding left. And I used to kind of just pop some stuff out of my back to actually get some crunches out of there. So this is actually the first podcast where we're actually right next to each other in basically what I'm referring to as Mole Man Studios V3 or version 3.
Mm-hmm.
My area is kind of a mess right now, as all that we basically did was move all of the extra stuff that we didn't need in the dining room area into other places.
Yes.
Moved my setup over here, and I haven't put up any pictures yet. I haven't put up any of my figurines. It's pretty much just like a white wall with Milhouse's head is what you'll see on the webcam right now.
Yes.
But over time, and when my body actually lets me do more work, because we're both so exhausted, that'll come in time where we set stuff up. I'll probably be able to actually have my Simpsons That Drummer Guy frame up
because, in camera view.
In camera view. As before, I always had it in front of me, but this time I'll have it behind me, and people can see a nice little birthday present I got a few years ago before the name change.
Yes.
Yeah, so I'm actually enjoying it over here. It's nice to be able to see your setup going on. I got my setup going on here, and hopefully this will lead to an even better show.
Absolutely.
And all of that said, talk about some nice positivity there. Boom! Let's talk about some stuff that's really going to depress us, because over the last several weeks, we've had to cover a lot of death.
Mm-hmm.
Some names that have really meant a lot to us, some more than others, others obviously. But this week, there's been 4 big deaths that have hit either one of us or both of us extremely hard.
Absolutely.
Now, where do we even start?
Well, we'll start. The original voice actress of Harley Quinn passed away. Arlene Sorkin, if I'm saying that correctly, he was 67 years old, so that's super sad.
Yeah. Anyone of my age group, maybe a little older, maybe a little younger, knows Batman the Animated Series, which of course has the best Joker of all time, Mark Hamill.
Hmm.
And boy, we should really discuss that at some point.
That will be a discussion point.
Yes. Of course, if you know the original voice actress, I mean, she has that Mr. J sound to her, which voice actress Tara Strong took over and made it even more of that Harley Quinn sound.
Yeah.
But The original voice died at 67. Very sad for the voice acting world because, of course, earlier this year, Kevin Conroy, the voice of Batman for so many different things, like Batman the Animated Series, Batman Arkham Trilogy, so many different things, different movies and everything, also died this year. So it's been really sad if you grew up watching Batman the Animated Series like I have.
Definitely. Also, Bernie Marsden, who was the original Whitesnake guitarist, passed away. I'm a huge Whitesnake fan, so that was hard. That was hard.
Yeah, unfortunately, you never got to see him, obviously. No. You know, he did write some legendary riffs with the band.
Definitely.
And it's really sad to have seen him go as well. Mm-hmm. And, you know, sadly, that's going to be happening a lot more with rock and roll lately. Ugh, I mean,
yes.
I'm really sad of who's next, but of course we got a few more names just to pound it into you that this has been a bad week.
Right? So then moving over into the wrestling world, Terry Funk passed away earlier this week.
One of my all-time favorite wrestlers growing up.
Mm-hmm.
I loved what he did in stuff like WCW, when he was briefly in WWF. Of course, when he later came back to WWF, doing the Chainsaw Charlie thing, which was just insane as well. But, of course, a lot of people probably know him best nowadays for his runs in ECW and All Japan, and doing all of his death matches that he's done all over the world. And it's absolutely insane that he was even able to live to this age, because I thought that he would have been gone much, much sooner, considering all of the pain that he's put his body through.
Sure.
And don't forget to check out Roadhouse, because he is a bouncer in Roadhouse, a pretty pivotal role in Roadhouse that a lot of people tend to forget about. But in case you're not a wrestling fan, check out Roadhouse and look for Terry Funk.
Yeah. And then most recently, we lost Wyndham Rotunda, also known as Bray Wyatt in the WWE. That one was shocking. That one was very shocking.
Yeah, whether he was Husky Harris, whether he was Bray Wyatt, whether he was The Fiend, he really gave it his all. And that really comes from the Rotunda family. Of course, his brother is Bo Dallas, not in WWE currently, but dating Liv Morgan, if I remember correctly.
Rumors were around that they did date anyways. I'm not sure if that's still the case.
Okay. Oh, that's a odd pull to pull. But of course, their dad is Mike Rotunda, who wrestled he wrestled under his own name in WCW.
Yes, yeah.
With the Z-Man as well. They were a very legendary tag team in WCW. But most people will, of course, know him best as IRS Irwin R. Scheister in WWF.
Yes.
With the Bray Wyatt situation, that one really hits close home to me because it turns out that Bray Wyatt got COVID earlier this year.
Yes.
And then has had heart failure ever since. And then on the day of his death, he had a heart attack that sadly finished him off.
Mm-hmm.
And the reason that hits so close to home is because that's exactly how my dad died.
Yeah.
And I could go into a whole political thing about COVID and all that stuff, but this is already sad enough stuff.
Right.
And I just want to say that he was only a year older than me. He was 36, and that is just way, way too young to go.
Way too young, yes. And of course, we also lost Bob Barker at the age of 99.
This week? Yesterday, as of recording this?
Yes. Well, yeah, yeah.
He was 99, which is the closest that you can get to 100 without going over.
Only you would make that joke at this time, but it is clever. But no,
that means he won. That's a positive thing.
Yeah. But no, Bob Barker just brings back so many great memories. My mom always watched that growing up, and I think every kid of a certain age, whenever you'd have that sick day and kind of be at home in bed with your soup and your ginger ale and crackers, and you'd have Bob Barker on every morning, and it'd just be great.
Yes, followed by The Young and the Restless, and then the noon news as well.
Exactly.
Of course, other people will probably know him from his cameo in Happy Gilmore. I've seen a lot of people talking about that more than The Price is Right. But of course, I will always remember him from The Price is Right and all the great games that he was a part of. I mean, the show has been going on for decades upon decades. And of course, he retired and Drew Carey, of all people, took over.
Yes.
But, you know, the Bob Barker, that was the golden era of not only The Price is Right, but just game shows in
general.
Absolutely. So, yeah, 5 deaths. You know, not the best way to start off the podcast,
but
hopefully we'll be able to bring in a little more positivity into the show this week.
Hopefully so.
So if that wasn't enough of a wink, wink, nudge, nudge, first off to say, we're going to be shifting things around because we're going to be covering AEW All In like we talked about. So a couple of our segments are going to be taking a break for the week. The musical roulette, which is the one that disappoints me the most that we're cutting out this week. It's my favorite segment of the week, but that will be coming back stronger than ever next week.
Absolutely.
I hope. We're also going to be resting the What's Your Problem for this week as well. One, again, because of all the stuff that's going on, and two, you couldn't really find anything for me to have a What's Your Problem with, so yeah. I'm going to give you an extra week to try to figure something out.
Yes, I have some I'm thinking about, but I knew this episode would be pretty long, so it's a good week to kind of pause on it.
So, like I hinted at before, we're going to try to make things a little more positive than the way we pretty much started off the show this week, covering 10 positive songs that, well, I'll let the Metal Faerie explain, because it's some really good reasoning why she wanted to do this week.
Yeah, so if you're not aware, as we roll into September later this week, that is also National Suicide Prevention Awareness Month. And as mental health is something very near and dear to both of us, as I'm sure it is many of you, I thought a good topic for our top 10 list would be top 10 songs that help us get through difficult times. This could be anything from songs that are just completely uplifting and inspiring to songs that are just relatable and kind of make you feel like you're not so alone in those times. It really kind of runs the gamut for both of us, I would say, and for you guys as well.
Yeah, I can already tell you that our lists are going to be quite varied.
I'm sure.
As well. It's not really sticking to one particular style or one cause or anything, because anyone who knows me knows that sometimes negative can be a positive, or depressing can be a positive thing, or other emotions that come along with that as well. But with all of that said, since this was your idea this week, we're going to have you start with your number 10.
Yeah. So my number 10 is Wilting in the Light by Light the Torch. This song is definitely one of those ones that it's not exactly uplifting, I wouldn't say. It's definitely one of those ones that just kind of is more relatable when you're going through stuff. When you really listen to the lyrics, it's kind of based more around a couple and kind of their disintegration. But so much of it, I think, is relatable to like any relationship you have, whether it be with people in your personal life or people you work with or just people you encounter like on a daily basis. One of the lines that always sticks with me from the song is, "The way you seem to live so effortless builds the walls around this emptiness." And that's something that just hits me so hard, because some days, whether I'm feeling down or whether I just feel down for the world, like seeing how some people are just able to kind of go about their lives without a care in the world, and I'm not, and so many others aren't, it just kind of hurts.
Yeah, that is definitely true of both of us. Even though I know it's against internet culture to really feel this way, but both of us are very empathetic.
Yes.
We both have that empath traits into both of us, and when we see bad stuff happen, it hits us both really, really hard. And
absolutely,
whether it's personal, whether it's the world, or anything in between, you know, it's just like, it's hard not to feel for other people, because, you know, whether you want people to feel that way when you're struggling, or you just relate to their struggles, whatever the case is, it's a very real thing.
Definitely.
And it's definitely a great song from Light Torch.
Abby, what's your number 10?
My number 10 is something that may not make a lot of sense, but it definitely makes a lot of sense for me. Off of Keeper of the Seven Keys Part 2, it is Halloween with I Want Out.
Oh, very nice.
Some could contribute this to be a libertarian anthem, which I disagree with. The way I look at this is, when I was growing up, I felt very trapped and alone in my home. Anyone who's ever checked out my Something Give series on YouTube knows exactly what I'm talking about with the struggles that I've dealt with my family. And when situations changed in early 2012, things had to change, and I needed to get out. And I especially started listening to the song more and more around that time, because I finally got to experience this idea of like being free from my family, being free from my hometown, and just being able to live life the way that I want to for a change, rather than always trying to make everyone else in my life happy. And it's still something I still struggle with to this day. I still wonder if I made the right choices or not.
Yeah.
But all in all, every year I try to just live for me, more and more,
yeah,
rather than the pain that I've left behind. So this battle cry of I want out, whatever your reasoning for it, it's something that is really motivational for me.
Definitely, and I absolutely love Halloween and this song. This was close to making my list because when I was a kid, this was like my song, and for different reasons than you. I grew up in a, thankfully, a very loving, amazing environment, but you know, even when you grow in a good environment, you have things that you deal with, and sometimes you just kind of need to put up your strength and your shield and kind of want to like pave your own path. So this one is near and dear, but really great song.
And also, you just loved it as a little kid. You found it fun, yes, and dancey and stuff. So
it was one of the first cassettes I bought as a child, if that indicates my age at all.
And that's why she's mine. So your number nine.
So my number nine is Lost by Death Angel. So
probably one of their best since they, if not their best song since they reunited.
Yeah, it's my favorite album from them, period, I would say, probably. I mean, I love Death Angel. I'm newer to Death Angel than probably a lot of people, probably in the last like 5-6 years. I can't remember when we left.
You're
them.
Welcome.
I know. But this song in particular, this one kind of along the lines of I Want Out, I think it's really kind of based around, you know, like somebody who's grown up in a really tough situation and made some bad choices and stuff like that. But again, it's so relatable to any kind of situation where you just feel like you're kind of at your wits. And again, one of the lines from this song that just kind of rings through so much to me is rain down on me and wash this pain away. Like, who doesn't feel that sometimes? You know, sometimes you just feel like you're crushed underneath things and you just need things to kind of stop and wash away.
It's so true. And yeah, I've been a long time Death Angel fan, and mm-hmm, I'm so glad that you got into him. And it's so funny because we saw Death Angel.
We did.
Opening for Cavalera Conspiracy. I interviewed Ted.
Yes.
From Death Angel right in front of you.
I know. And I don't even remember it now.
It was like right in front of their tour bus at First Ave. And you couldn't have cared less, really.
I know. And if you did it now, I'd be like, oh my God, that's Ted.
And then when we saw him live, you started to like them a little bit more.
Yeah, I enjoyed seeing them, but I didn't really seek him out yet.
Yeah, but of course, with your style of how you do everything, you need to listen alone. Usually when you go off on your bi-weekly venture away from the apartment, you have, yes, to listen to stuff by yourself.
Absolutely.
And you have to check out the music for yourself, whether you see them live, whether I show them to you, whatever the case is.
Yes. What's your number nine?
My number nine might be a shock to a lot of people. I mean, considering, you know, like a lot of the interviews that I've done over the years, it covers a lot of death metal, grindcore, black metal, a lot of it with some satanic imagery along with it as well. But this band is a Christian band. It's a Christian metal band known as Demon Hunter, and it is a song off the album Extremis called The Last One Alive. This is probably the one Demon Hunter song that you do know. If you heard it, you would recognize what it is immediately. Okay. But it is a song that, ever since it came out, it was definitely something that really hit me hard. And it's just that idea of wanting to die happy. You know, whether I'm the last person on earth or I die too early, I want to be able to live the best life that I possibly can while I'm here. I'm sick of waiting for good things to happen. I'm, yeah, sick of people trying to do good things for me. It's why I don't ask favors of people. It's why I barely reach out to anybody, because, yeah, you know, it's like I like doing that myself, and also I don't like the idea of owing people favors. But besides the point, you know, just that idea of like living life the best that you can. It's a hard song, but it's a very positive song. The same idea of it's like it's really motivational to live life while you're still here.
Well, I am not familiar with song by name anyways. I know I've heard Demon Hunter before, but
actually a little pause for the cause. I'm just going to show you a couple seconds for this. We'll be right back. Okay, so that didn't go to plan, but at least you like the song. Hearing it.
Yes.
You didn't remember it, but you did like it.
Yeah.
So, after that weird transition, what is your number eight?
My number eight is I Want to Be Somebody by Wasp. For me, this is probably the most kind of straight up song on my list. It's just kind of having that the power in you, kind of cry it out to the world that you want to be somebody, you want to make something of yourself, and not letting anybody kind of get in your way.
Yeah, it's a really good song. Of course, it's arguably the biggest Wasp song. Not my favorite, of course. Animal is, of course, the best Wasp song, and I will not
disagree.
Hear different.
Disagree.
Oh,
disagree.
We should have a fun talk about that at some point
we
on
will.
Here.
We will.
But yeah, I think it's a very good motivational song when it comes to that.
Absolutely. Absolutely. So what is your number?
My number 8 is just stupid, silly fun with the band Trollfest.
Nice.
Off of their EP Happy Heroes with the title track Happy Heroes. This is just a silly Billy song. Just a silly goose of a song about all of the Trollfest members being actual trolls and going on mischievous adventures. But it puts me in such a positive mood. It gets me happy. It puts a smile on my face when I hear it. The chorus is so sing-along and so silly. It's just, it's fun to enjoy. And of course, you know, Trollfest is always going to be near and dear to my heart because that's when we met each other for the first time, was during Trollfest.
Yes. Yeah. Trollfest is a fun band. I mean, there's no doubt about that. It's just it's always going to be a fun time listening to them. I get it.
Oh, definitely. So you're number 7.
My number 7 is Savage Heart by Pretty Maids. So this song, it's just kind of about how, you know, after going through loss and pain and, you know, everything bad in this world, it's going to break you down. It's going to hurt your heart. But that savage heart that's still there is still beating and it's still going to go on and you're still going to go on. And as much as things are terrible, like if you're still here, you're still going.
Yeah, that is a heart-ripping song.
Oh, for sure.
Like, of course, everything that's going on with Ronnie Atkins right now. It's just, you know, like you look back at that and it's just like it hurts a little more, but it's also a little more optimistic at the same time as well, because even through everything that he's going through right now, he has such a positive mindset. He hasn't stopped making music. He has a new solo album coming out this month, I believe, or October. I can't remember which one it is, but he's got another solo album and he's still got plans to make more music.
Yeah, and I think we talked about it before, but call out to his new single that's out. It's so optimistic for a man who is dealing with what he is dealing with right now, but just kind of taking every day as a gift and, you know, making the most of life.
And, you know, that also goes again with, you know, like the suicide prevention and awareness and all of that stuff, because when you're dealing with thoughts like that, and trust me, this is Mr. Conductor here, I know what I'm talking about when it comes to suicidal thoughts and attempts. If you can find anything to help you keep going, or even just that idea of not wanting to end life at your worst, which is the one thing that's keeping me going, much like I talked about with Demon Hunter and Halloween so far, is I don't want to die sad. I want to die happy at a point where I can look back in my life and realize that it was worth all the struggles that I went through. And I really hope Ronnie's feeling that way right now. And I, you know, especially from that new single, it definitely sounds that way.
What's your number 7?
My number 7 is probably the most optimistic melodic death metal band out there. It is my favorite melodic death metal band. It's my favorite Finnish band of all time. It is Omnium Gatherum with Be the Sky off The Burning Cold, which is arguably my favorite Omnium Gatherum album. It kind of changes sometimes, but this is the one that just I always keep going back to. And no, it's not just because of how much Dan Swanö is a part of this album on the production side.
Just a bonus.
Yes, but this particular song is like kind of like what we're talking about here with the mental health stuff, where sometimes you have to deal with the struggles that you go through in life on your own. You can't expect someone else to be able to solve them for you. You can't expect life or a higher power, or whatever you choose to believe is going to fix things for you. Sometimes you have to do it yourself. You have to do the work. You have to be the positivity in your own life, because if you can't be positive for yourself, who can be? And with a song like Be the Sky, you know, it's just like you are the vastness. You are the world. You are you. So make the most of it that you possibly can, because either it can be nice and sunny or it can be thunderstorms and natural disasters all the time. Do what you can to focus on the positive.
Yeah, I love Omnium Gatherum. They're amazing. So they have a lot of inspirational songs. That's a good choice.
Yeah, and it's so funny with them too, because when you think of a melodic death metal band, you think of just anger,
right?
You think of negativity.
Yeah.
But Omnium Gatherum is the polar opposite to the band Insomnium, which of course shares members of the band. But like Insomnium is that dark side, but Omnium Gatherum is the positive side.
Yeah.
And I love that so much.
Definitely.
So your number 6.
My number 6 is Misery's Crown by Dark Tranquillity. So this one is very much about, you know, things bring you down and you can get to the point where you put up these massive walls around you and to the point where you just don't care about things or anything, and like, and you feel like, why should you? And I'm very familiar with that, because I am a person who has pretty big walls built up around me with anybody I meet. But at the same time, kind of having that mindset of, you know, if you know the chorus, don't bring your misery down on me. Like, you've had enough and you don't need any more, and just kind of up that wall wall to let people's negativity affect you anymore. Ew.
Yeah, it's one of the best known Dark Tranquility songs for a good reason. Absolutely. It's such a great song. It's a great message. And it sounds depressing as all get go. It's a very depressing sounding song, but especially when you take the lyrics and the musical content and, of course, Michael Stane's vocals into account, it can be a very positive thing.
Abby, what's your number six?
My number six is in the exact opposite direction here with a song that, well, a band that I listen to when I'm at my absolute most furious. Mm-hmm. This is a band that when, especially around the time of my brother dying in 2019 and all the horror stories that I've had to deal with him over the years, this particular song came out right around the time that he died. It's from a band called Ringworm, and it's off the album Death Becomes My Voice, but it's a song that you can pretty much tell what it's about from the title, I Want to Tear the World Apart. It's the kind of song, it's short, it's sweet, it feels like you can take all of your aggressions of the world, of everything that has hurt you, and you're able to just, like, violently go in the pit for about 2.5 minutes, and all of your anger is gone.
Yeah.
You're able to just expunge all of it. You're binging the anger. You're purging it at the same time. And I know this is not a band for you. I showed you one of the newer songs, which we'll be talking about at the end of the show with my top 10 of August, where they have a new album out, and
yeah,
it was definitely your least favorite of all 10
yeah
albums.
Yeah.
But, yeah, this is my anger band, and don't let people fool you. You need anger in your life. You need all the emotions in your life, because
absolutely,
if you try to hide any of your emotions, it's going to come out in terrible ways.
It's just going to build up. But yeah, they're not my cup of tea, but that's okay.
She still puts up with me somehow, some way.
Somehow.
Number five.
Number five is Sorrow by Bad Religion. So Bad Religion has a lot of really good lyrical content, I'll just say. This song in particular, though, it's really kind of breaking down, you know, if we could do all these different things, if we could stop fighting with each other, if we could have equality, if we could stop, like, power games and all these things, personally and from a broader scope for sure, maybe we could be in a world that's better, where people don't have to suffer and be sorrowful all the time. You know, people could actually live full lives and not have to worry about basic things that they shouldn't have to worry about.
Would you say there would be no sorrow no more?
No more. Yes.
Yes, I love Bad Religion, one of my favorite punk bands of all time. They're smart, which is probably the biggest reason you like them, is because of all the degrees the band has.
People, yes.
Although not when it comes to metal, but that is definitely a different conversation for a different time. Because there's a lot of smart tech death bands out there that you would never give the time of day that also have degrees and stuff.
I might like the people, just not their music.
We'll discuss that at some point.
Sure.
But yeah, it's such a great song. It's one of their slower songs in the midst of everything, but it's still, you know, it still has that great mid-tempo stuff going on there, but it is a great song.
What's your number five?
My number five is a song that most people will never take seriously, but it's a good battle cry for any metalhead out there, from Freedom Call, off of the album Master of Light, the song Metal is for Everyone. And I love the message of this because, you know, 20 years ago this year, I really went deep into metal. Like I've mentioned before, I only listened to Metallica up to this point, and then in 2003, I started my metal journey after Saint Anger came out, because I had to find something better out there.
Mm-hmm.
And I was just some random person. I didn't know I was going to be into metal when I was younger, in my younger days. It was just something that really meant near and dear to me.
Yeah.
The more that I grew up with it and discovered all these different genres, all these different styles. And when I just look at all the hate spewed throughout social media or shows or anything else that goes on, with just the bicker that goes on between metalheads and what is metal, what's not metal, this band is good, this band is crap, all the negativity, which I could easily capitalize on and be one of the bigger names in metal YouTube. But I would not feel comfortable with myself doing that.
Yeah.
I love the inclusivity of metal because I love all these different styles, and whether someone likes it or not does not mean that I'm not going to like it or I'm not going to like it anymore because someone else doesn't like it. I like a lot of music that you will never enjoy at all when it comes to the metal field.
Yeah.
And I just love this message from Freedom Call where let everyone enjoy what they enjoy.
Yes.
It's a lost message, especially on the social media age, but it's one that I feel needs to keep going out there because no matter what genre you don't like, if you keep gatekeeping others from enjoying that, they're going to become bitter and maybe they'll never enjoy the music that you enjoy. It might start costing bands merchandise or tickets or whatever else. It's just, it's so harmful. But people think, oh, it's just conversation, man, whatever, yeah. I'm just saying my opinions, you know, Trump 2024. But, you know, it's but it's so harmful to the human psyche.
Absolutely.
And it's something to some people where it's so meaningless, like metal, means a lot to a lot of people. Mm-hmm. So don't hurt people like that.
Absolutely. I mean, metal, like punk, like a lot of rock and stuff like that. I mean, it's kind of a home for misfits. And as a misfit, you should know how terrible it feels when you're excluded purposely. So why do you want to make other people feel like that? Like, don't be so fickle. Don't be so stupid. Just get over yourself. Your music is no better than anybody else's. We just all have different opinions.
Yes. And just to stress it one more time, you can hate anything you want to.
Absolutely.
We're not here to say that you need to like this, that, or the other thing.
No.
Just stop telling people to stop enjoying what they enjoy.
Quit judging.
Yeah. Quit judging and making people feel less because it's not what you enjoy.
Exactly.
So on that note, number four.
My number four is Still Alive by Nocturnal Rites. They have a few songs that are pretty uplifting for me. This song in particular, kind of similar to some of the other songs I've had, but it's just kind of when you're so broken down, but you're still alive. You're still alive. You still have a voice to continue on. If you're still here, you still have a fighting chance. And it's just taking that chance.
An excellent song off an excellent album. And yeah, it has a great message.
Absolutely.
I really appreciate that, especially of a band like Nocturnal Rites being able to cover something like that as well.
For sure. What's your number four?
My number four is from one of the most depressing bands of all time, but on the opposite side, it's probably their most positive song that they've ever written. Of course, I'm talking about Woods of Ypres off of Woods 4, the Green album, with the song Don't Open the Wound, which, if you couldn't tell by the title, it's basically about all the things that are hurting you mentally, physically, everything. Stop picking at it. Stop thinking about it all the time. Stop letting it control you, because the wound will never heal if you don't leave it alone.
Yeah.
As much as it hurts, all of the horrible things that have happened in life, and particularly on this album with Woods 4, every song has to do with a breakup in some way, shape, or form. You know, it's just like, if you just fester the idea of a relationship broken, you'll never be able to move on with yourself. You'll never be able to have a meaningful life if you feel like your life is already done. So just do what you can to be able to power on.
And obviously it's a lot easier said than done, because sometimes it's hard to kind of get your mind into different spaces and not focus on that stuff. But doing anything you can to kind of put your mind somewhere else, get your body and mind somewhere else, that's the best way.
Couldn't agree more. So number three.
Number three for me is Me Against the World by Lizzie Borden. So this is one that's been near and dear since I was a kid. Just as somebody who has felt like I've never really fit in and just kind of very alone my entire life, it just, you know, makes you feel strong, like you're strong enough to take on the world. And I love that, because I mean, when you feel that strength inside of you that lets you actually get out there and things done and become the person that you want to be.
Yeah, I couldn't agree more. And that does remind me, there is a new Lizzie Borden single. I don't think we've checked out yet, unless you did on your own.
Yeah.
But that is a great song and a great message, and hopefully it'll change at some point. But one of the second to last band that we've seen live was Lizzie Borden.
Yes.
And they put on such a great show.
Amazing show. And I never thought I'd get to see them in my life. But so happy I was able to.
Unfortunately, there was a headliner that I don't want to be the last band I ever see live.
Yeah.
But we'll see what happens with that.
Exactly. What's your number three?
My number three is from, again, I've mentioned this so many times in so many different spaces, King's X every year becomes closer and closer to being my favorite band of all time. And I say that without having a favorite band of all time because my moods change so much in different styles. Yeah. But King's X is always a comfort music band for me. And while not every album hits for me, enough of them do. And especially the album Ear Candy is a great example of that, where the entire album pretty much lives up to the title. It does feel like Ear Candy, but this song in particular, A Box, is a song about literally or figuratively not keeping yourself in a box. You know, there's so many people, there's so many things in life that will tell you what you can and can't be. And that's putting a box, and that's putting the walls around you about what you can accomplish and what you can't. Mm-hmm. And this song is literally about getting out of that box.
Yeah.
And just whether you just want to prove people wrong out of spite, whether you have something meaningful you want to be able to do with your life, whether you just want to challenge yourself, whatever the case is, just the idea of not living inside a box and of like things just have to be this way because they are this way and you can't change it is not the way life can go and should not go. And a lot of times we do have the power to change that.
I adore King Saku, and this is a great one, so this is a very X.
Well, thank you very much.
Of course.
Numero dos.
So I will preface my number two by saying I take a completely different meaning from the song than one was intended, but I'll get into that. And you've heard this song on the show before. It is Let the Storm Descend Upon You by Avantasia. So
very interesting.
Yeah. So I know the meaning that's going, it's going for is kind of dragging you into the quote unquote dark side and kind of dragging you over to bad stuff and all that stuff. But I always have taken it differently because if you're familiar with the chorus, it's shine your light into the darkness and let the storm descend upon you. And to me,
and I will make you mine.
I know. But that's Yorn just coming on to us, you know. But no, the shine your light into the darkness, I know it's meant to like kind of drag your light down and like kind of put that out with the darkness. But to me, I take it the other way. It's, you know, yeah, bring on the storm, let it descend upon me, and there's darkness all around me, but I'm gonna shine my light into it and I'm gonna find my way through it. And that's the way I've always taken it. And like when I hear the chorus, and especially like if I'm alone listening to this, I start crying every single time because it just has that meaning to me so deep.
And that totally makes a lot of sense with your interpretation of it. Mm-hmm. Obviously, with the concept that's going on with it, that is not what it's about.
And I totally get that.
But I love that. I love that about art and music is that you're able to take your own interpretation from it. And
absolutely.
If you can find something positive out of the darkness like that, that's such a great thing.
Definitely. What's your number two?
My number two really hits home with the theme of why we're doing this. Mm-hmm. Why the Metal Faerie wanted to cover this specifically, of course, with next month being such a heavy month when it comes to mental health.
Yes.
And a band that deals a lot with mental health, specifically vocalist Jesse Leach. Mm-hmm. It is Killswitch Engage off of their latest album, Atonement, which I know they're working on new music, and of course Adam D and Howard Jones are working on a new project. Ooh. Right now too. Eventually one day it's gonna be Killswitch Engage featuring Jesse Leach and Howard Jones.
Fingers
that
crossed.
Will be happening one day.
Fingers
I can
crossed.
Just feel it. But this song made me cry the first time I heard it. When you came home from work, mm-hmm. I had you sit down and watch the music video.
Yes.
And you bursted out crying.
Absolutely.
As well. It is I Am Broken Too.
Yes.
Which is pretty much a life staple of what I've been trying to do ever since I've been open about my mental health struggles is, yes, I am a depressed, suicidal, anxiety-ridden, traumatic-filled guy. But that doesn't mean that I can't help others that are feeling similarly. That doesn't mean that I can't listen to others that are going through pain. That doesn't mean I'm trying to have a peeing contest about who has it worse, which I really, really hate when that happens, when either people are saying, oh, you don't have it this bad, look at this, or, you think that's bad, look at what I had to go through. No.
Yeah.
Every person handles things differently.
Yeah.
Mentally, physically, everything.
Mm-hmm.
Everyone handles things differently. And we're all broken.
Yes.
And if we're not broken yet, it's only because we don't realize that we're broken.
Yes.
And everybody needs help in some way, shape, or form. Sometimes it is from a doctor or a therapist or a psychiatrist. Sometimes it's from someone who just cares about you. Sometimes it takes a life change or a course correction in life. There's so many things that it can come from. But, you know, just knowing everything that I've gone through especially when I was younger, the one thing I wish I could have had when I was dealing with, especially my first few suicide attempts and before I became honest with my mental health stuff, was I wish someone was there saying, I've dealt with these feelings too, and it can be okay. Doesn't necessarily mean it will, but it can be okay. And that is just something that I think should be a message all the way around. It's something that if anyone comes to me, and a lot of people have over the years, I've been told many a times I've stopped suicide attempts because they've reached out to me. And that's something that means more to me than almost anything else in the world. That I've been able to help save lives just from being there, being able to talk to people, and just being able to share scars and just know that they're not alone and they need to keep trying.
Yeah, this is probably my favorite Killswitch song and my favorite Killswitch album at this point. Granted, I'm still kind of newer to Killswitch and kind of still going back and discovering their discography and stuff, but this was another one that was very close to making my list. It has so much very...
I'm honestly surprised it didn't make your list, for especially for the reasons.
Yeah, I mean, for the most part, all of my songs, like, while some of them are negative, I tried to have ones that have some kind of a positive in there somewhere. Really, the only one against that was Light the Torch, but then, you know, that's related, I would say. So.
Very much so.
Yeah.
So, and speaking of that, your most positive song.
So my number one, and I'm going to try to go through this without crying.
Hey, I'm already weeping talking about what I did. I know. So, you know, do what you got to do.
So it is Power of Will by Dynasty. So,
were you going to say Dynasty?
I was going to. We always jokingly say Dynasty. Stewie Griffin, if you've seen Family Guy, he says
it's Dynasty,
like,
Brian.
Exactly. But no, I've dealt with anxiety and depression probably a lot of my life, but I've never really dealt with it, so to speak. I've always kind of been there for other people and, you know, personally, professionally, everything. I always kind of put other people first. And then last fall came around, and we'll just say there was a lot of stuff going on in my life last year. And I got to a point where not only was I dealing with emotional stuff, but my anxiety was starting to have a physical impact on me. I was having dizzy spells. I was having, on a daily basis, I'd have multiple times where I would just sit and cry for hours on end. I just felt like my world lapping. And this is one of the songs that really helped me through this time. One of the lines that still sticks out to me that I listened to over and over again at the time was, through the power of will, I'll find my stillness. Because I felt like my world was spinning and I just want that stillness. And it gave me the strength to really rise above things and tackle things finally. So I finally went to the doctor and I got a medication and I started therapy and I finally started feeling a little bit better. Am I cured? Absolutely not. This is a lifelong thing. Am I, you know, still dealing with things on a daily basis? Sure. But I'm not where I was a year ago. I'm better than I was then. And it really just kind of taught me that, you know, the only way to get from a point where you are feeling so low that, like, your world is just spinning and crashing around you to a point where you feel better is going through it. You need to dive through it and get through it, because you can't skirt around it. You can't, you know, just hope and dream for something. You gotta make things happen yourself somehow, some way, whether that's medication or therapy or whatever it is. There's ways out there to get through it. Just need to find it. So that's my number one.
I love that. I'm not as familiar with the song and band, obviously. I mean, there's a lot of stuff that, especially in the power metal, symphonic metal, and glam rock worlds, that you know much more than I do. But of course, you've shown me stuff over that time. But the fact that you're able to take such meaning from something like that, and obviously I know the pain of last year that went through all of that, seeing it from the other side, because, you know, it's like I go through this constantly, and I can only imagine what's on your mind when you're seeing me struggle the way that I do.
Right.
And to see it happen to you just shattered my world, and I imagine I keep doing that to you constantly, so I can never apologize enough for doing that. But I am glad that you've taken some steps.
Yeah.
And, like, everyone makes mistakes, everyone falls down, but you gotta pick yourself back up and be able to just try to keep going. And I'm so glad that you've taken steps over that time, and I know you're struggling with stuff right now. I mean, of course, when you start to deal with it and you start to realize things, you know, whether it's going on in your head, or it's the world around you, you know, it's like things can really start to bring you down. But I am so glad that you're at least trying, because that's everything. My number one has been my battle cry since I was a little kid. It's a song that I have never heard enough times. It's a song that means so much to me. I was able to cover it in my metal cover band that I had. Funny enough, the last show that we ever did, we had the lights and sound shut off on us before the set was done. But we would normally start with this song because of the way that it starts and everything. But it is, funny enough, Suicidal Tendencies off the album Lights, Camera, Revolution with You Can't Bring Me Down, a song that I try to internalize every time I get to my worst. Because the song is just about everything in life trying to literally bring you down. But if you just have that strong will about you, if you have that power behind you and you want to make things better for yourself or whatever, you can do it. Don't let the negativity control you. Let you control you. And of course, it hasn't always worked for me, but it is the song that I go to the most when I am having those breakdowns that I do. And it's just so funny because, you know, it's like, it's a crossover thrash song. You wouldn't necessarily think it would be like the most optimistic, positive song out there. But for someone like me who grew up with the horrible family, living conditions, so many things wrong with my life, I need a different take on positivity.
Yeah.
And this song does that for me.
I'm not super familiar with this song, but that was like an amazing meaning to
it. And we saw it live when we saw Suicidal Tendencies when they opened for Megadeth. It was the first song they played.
Yeah. You're learning all my quirks, guys.
Well, if people haven't learned my quirks yet, they'll find more of them with you as well.
Sure.
But those are our collective top 10 positive rock metal songs to get us through. And if you're listening to this, please, in the comments, wherever you're checking this out, please let us know what are some songs that help you get through the roughest times that you're going through.
Yeah.
Be it social media, YouTube, wherever else.
And if you're out there and dealing with stuff similar to us or completely different, just know that there are people out there who care. The world is a better place within it, and there are resources, and we will put those in the information.
Yes, absolutely. And we're going to be doing that all month of September to help support that as well.
Absolutely.
Even if we're not necessarily going to be covering those grounds,
yes,
it's very important to encourage that in that month. And I want to say before we end that, just because we're going to be doing that for the month doesn't mean that the other 11 months don't matter when
absolutely
it comes to that. Every single day counts.
Yes.
It's when something like this happens for a month, it's a reminder.
Yes.
It's not the only time to care.
Mm-hmm.
All right, so for this next little bit here, like we mentioned at the top of the show, we are recording this after AEW All In 2023 at Wembley Stadium in London, England.
Yes.
And we actually haven't even talked about the pay-per-view yet to each other.
No.
We were just waiting for the media scrum. It took too long and we decided, F it, we're just going to start recording the show and we'll just occasionally look and see if anything happens during the media scrum.
Exactly.
And from what I could tell, it didn't look like there was any physical altercations that were talked about, but
yeah.
I'm sure once we're done recording, we'll look online and probably tug our collars a couple times over stuff that we've already heard about.
Yes.
You know, why don't we talk about that first before we actually get into the matches?
Yeah. So there's some rumors that there was an altercation backstage between Mr. CM Punk, who is notorious for altercations at this point, and Jack Perry.
Yes. From what I understand, it had to do with a few weeks back on AEW Collision, where Jack Perry wanted to do a match where they were using real glass instead of sugar glass, which I hate to be Dr. Oz here and looking behind the curtain to see what's going on, but when you usually see glass spots in wrestling, it's not real glass. It's sugar
glass. It's still real to me.
It's still real, but it's less gonna kill you if it sticks into your body.
Yeah.
But he wanted to use real glass, and apparently CM Punk had a real big problem with that because he's the head honcho on AEW Collision now. And after Jack Perry's match at All In today, the two of them got into an altercation where CM Punk put Jack Perry into a chokehold.
Yes.
And after all this, you would think that CM Punk, after being physically altercating with someone, he'd be asked to leave.
Yeah.
No. Jack Perry was asked to leave the premises.
Yeah. Apparently CM Punk can do no wrong. Apparently they have no HR department, and I think that Tony Khan is afraid of CM Punk.
Yes, as I'm looking at Tony Khan right now, during his media scrum, I definitely see some fear in his eyes once he leaves the media scrum and having to deal with some more stuff.
Larry is waiting backstage for him.
That, of course, is CM Punk's bulldog named Larry.
Yes.
But let's actually go over the matches here.
Yeah.
Or should we talk about how we overall felt about the pay-per-view? Do you want to save that first or last?
We can go through it first, yeah. I mean, it was fine. It was fine. There were some decent matches. There wasn't a whole lot of, like, surprise things or anything like that. Well, at least none that I cared about. But we'll get into that more. But it was fine.
I found it thoroughly enjoyable, but I was not able to enjoy it to my fullest due to being in a lot of physical pain right now from all the moving that we did for Mole Man Studios.
Yeah.
But there was a couple times I wanted to fall asleep because I was in so much pain.
Yeah.
But I stayed awake for the content. Yes. Hashtag for the content. So I did make it through everything here, and we'll be going over this as there is 11 matches to be able to go over to with the pre-show known as Zero Hour. And that first match was MJF and Adam Cole against Aussie Open for the Ring of Honor Tag Team Championships.
Yeah. I thought this was a decent match. I mean, I do really enjoy MJF and Adam Cole together, and I know, like, we're kind of debating what we thought was going to happen with them throughout this pay-per-view and in the future as well, because they were not exactly friends not too long ago. So it's kind of a unique friendship that has come together there, so we weren't sure what was going to happen. And I know with this one, I did predict that MJF and Adam Cole were going to win, and you had predicted Aussie Open. And lo and behold, I was right.
Yeah, you were right. And you have every right to gloat. And it does make sense, especially with the ending of the show. It also makes sense as well, because it really had a lot of story impact for the main event. But yeah, I thought it was a really good, fun match to be on a pre-show, if nothing else. But yeah, I thought it was good.
Yeah, so the next one up was Hook versus Jack Perry for the FTW championship, which was supposed to be kind of discontinued, so to speak. But that didn't really happen.
We didn't watch Collision last night, so we don't exactly know what happened other than this match got announced.
Exactly. So I know you had predicted that Hook would win. I had predicted Jack Perry, and you won on this one.
Yes. And just the funny turn of events of everything that happened with Jack Perry after this match, it really makes me wonder what's going to be happening in the future for the person known as Jack Perry.
Yes.
The physical specimen.
Yes.
But I did not care about this match whatsoever.
No.
They haven't really done enough to make me care about the FTW title. I mean, even when it was in ECW, I didn't care about it. It was just a little prop for Taz.
Well, yeah.
Which is Hook's dad.
Yeah, that's the thing. It's not an official title, so it's like, why are we caring about this? And I do like Jack Perry quite a bit. I just feel like they need to like more of them at this point.
Yes, and even with him stealing many of Rob Van Dam's moves in this match.
Yes. So next up, we had CM Punk versus Samoa Joe for the quote-unquote real world championship, which again is not a real championship. It's just CM Punk coming up with a championship.
No, it's officially recognized by Tony Khan.
Yeah, I don't believe it. Anyways, we both predicted CM Punk would win, and he did.
Yeah, this was a match I wanted to enjoy, but I knew Samoa Joe wasn't going to win.
Yeah.
And I really wanted him to, not just because he is the body of Sweet Tooth and Twisted Metal, but I've always enjoyed Samoa Joe in some way, shape, or form.
Yeah.
And it's just so funny because, like, with politically and musically, I couldn't agree with CM Punk more on a lot of things.
Yeah.
But when it comes to looking out for number one, I despise him.
Yeah. I mean, Samoa, he's such a good heel, especially, like, I love his heel work. But CM Punk, like, I think I've talked about this before, but I never, like, grew up watching him. But I started to like him when he first came to AEW. But, like, the stuff that he's done backstage is just not cool of me. So, I mean, it was a fine match, but, like, it's hard when you're not invested in it.
And it's going to be interesting next week. Will there be more altercations on the official one-year anniversary of Brawl Out?
Stay tuned.
All right. Next, we had Tanoshka Takeshka and Bullet Club Gold, probably the worst faction in AEW
now.
Of Juice Robinson and Jay White, along with the Guns, Austin and Colton Gunn out there. And, of course, their manager, but not manager, Don Callis. I'm really confused on everything that's going on with that. Facing what I call the Hung Golden Lovers.
Yes.
Hangman Adam Page, Kenny Omega, and Kota Ibushi, who thankfully put on a great match, and it was great seeing the Golden Lovers and everything go on again. But for some horrible reason, this Bullet Club Gold thing had to beat them.
I know. We both predicted the Golden Elite was going to win because they should have. They were the better team. Because the Guns are just not good. They're not good. But I mean, it was an enjoyable match. It was fun to watch, but it definitely ended the wrong way.
Although I will say this, and I'll be saying it again later. Don Callis is a treasure.
I love Don Callis. He is the best thing to ever happen to us.
Next up, we have FTR versus the Young Bucks for the AEW World Tag Team Championship in one of the better matches of the night. I mean, yeah. It's hard for me to feel kind of invested because of the whole CM Punk thing, and FTR sided with them, and then the Young Bucks are the executive vice presidents of AEW, and it's just like there's so much turmoil outside of wrestling that's making me enjoy the match less.
Yeah.
But it was a great match, although I was really hoping that the Young Bucks were going to win because one particular member of FTR, if you checked out the show last week, was arrested for aggravated assault with a firearm.
Oops.
But apparently Tony Khan decided that they should still have the titles.
Yeah, so in this case, you had predicted the Young Bucks, I predicted FDR, and yeah, the FTR came out the winners at the end. It was an enjoyable match, but just, yeah, it was kind of hard to figure out what was going to go there. Next up, we had Eddie Kingston, Orange Cassidy, and the Best Friends, which are Chuck Taylor and Trent Beretta. Along with Penta El Zero, Miedo, and they went against the Blackpool Combat Club with John Moxley, Claudio, and Wheeler Yuta, and then also Santana and Ortiz, who
making their return.
Yes, made their return, were with them as well. So what do you think about this? And this is supposed to be the Stadium Stampede, which I feel like it didn't really live up to that.
No, if you've ever checked out a Stadium Stampede match from AEW, they used the whole stadium.
Emptied out.
Like, they would go on the football field or... Yes. Yeah, where they had the matches, it was at the Jacksonville Jaguars football stadium.
Mm-hmm.
It was the actual stadium that they used.
Mm-hmm.
They were fun matches. There was crazy things that happened.
Yes.
And that's not to say that there wasn't some crazy stuff that happened here, some things that really made me wince. But it was a hardcore match. Like, they explored a couple areas in the back, like a hallway and one little, like, VIP area.
Mm-hmm.
But the rest of it was out in the actual match entranceway.
Yeah, and, you know, from the one hand, I get that the people there want to see it live and stuff. They just want something that's just pre-recorded. But then don't promote it as a Stadium Stampede because we have our expectations set at this point, and that's not what we're getting. but in this case, we both had predicted that the Blackpool Combat Club would win, but they did not.
Much to my surprise. I mean, especially with the returning Santana and Ortiz, which I have said since day one of AEW Dynamite, Santana and Ortiz are my favorite tag team.
Yes.
And they should have had a tag team title run by now.
Absolutely.
And I hope they will. I mean, I'm not sure if they're with the Blackpool Combat Club right now. I mean, from everything, it seems like they just joined up with them for this match, but they might be joining up with them completely. I have no idea. But all I know is I want to see them take the titles off from FTR and actually put them around their waist because they finally deserve it.
Absolutely. And I think they'd be a good addition to Blackpool Combat Club because they don't really have a designated tag team at this point. One surprise that did, well, surprise, quote unquote, that did happen during this, they kind of faked a neck injury with Penta. So he was brought back to the backstage to have medical attention. And then briefly later, he came out with a costume change and came out as his alter ego.
Hey, Penta Oscolo.
Yes.
The evil side of Penta.
Yes, yes.
Which is absolutely a Lucha Libre... I'm forgetting the company now. Lucha Underground.
Yes.
Definitely a Lucha Underground thing to do something like that.
Absolutely.
So next was the lone women's match out of all 11 matches. It seems like there wasn't enough room to put a second women's match on
here.
But it was Hikaru Shida as the champion for AEW Women's Championship, facing Toni Storm, Britt Baker, and the hometown girl, Saraya.
Yes.
Now, you were away during pretty much this entire match.
This was my bathroom break match.
Wasn't even by choice. It just happened that way.
It just happened.
Saraya came out to We Will Rock You by Queen.
Oh, boy.
Which, as soon as that happened, she came out with her entire family and everything. And I knew right then and there, I was wrong. She was going to win.
Yes, because you had guessed that Shida was going to win.
Yeah, because she just won the title a couple weeks ago. So why would you take the title off her?
Hot potato.
I hate hot potatoing for championships.
But I had predicted that Saraya would win, and I came out victorious.
Yes, you did, for a match you didn't even watch.
Exactly.
The only thing of note here was Saraya and Toni Storm are two-thirds of the Outcasts, which seems to more or less be broken up at this point now, because Toni Storm and Saraya started bickering and fighting during the match, and their third member, Ruby Soho, came out for all of 45 seconds to get smacked in the face and leave again.
What a trip.
For the lone women's match, this was really, really disappointing. And one of the shortest matches of the night as well.
Yeah.
It wasn't even 10 minutes.
No. So up next, we had Darby Allin and Sting versus Swerve Strickland and Christian Cage in a coffin match.
Or Christian. Christian. However you want to pronounce it. Or whoever you want to pronounce it.
Yes.
Yes, this was a coffin match. And normally, I'm all for the coffin and casket matches.
Yeah.
This one disappointed me because I wanted this so badly to have two coffins. It's a tag team match.
Yeah.
Both members should be in one huge coffin or two coffins.
Yes.
That's how it should be. Mm-hmm. And especially with the ending that happened, which makes things even more hilarious. I did find it to be an enjoyable match.
Yes.
And seeing Sting in his mid-60s still going just as good as other AEW wrestlers is quite the sight to see.
He is amazing.
And of course, I had to do my Prince Nana dances during it as well. I don't know what's wrong with me, but whenever I see him dance, every time. But the match ended with Darby Allin and Sting defeating Swerve Strickland and Christian. Christian was not the one put in the coffin. Swerve was.
Yes.
But his hair was sticking out of the coffin.
Yeah, so it didn't really win, but we're going with that, I guess. But we both did predict that one right. One thing I did appreciate is with a lot of Darby's coffin mattresses in the past, they've used like the super old school like wooden coffins that you're used to seeing in like Nosferatu and stuff. And like, but this one was an actual like modern coffin that I'm used to in like the WWE matches back in the day. So that was kind of cool, at least.
Oh, and also I should point this out for all you WCW kids out there. Sting and Darby Allin came out to Metallica's Seek and Destroy.
Yes.
Which for a very short period of time during the WCW Mayhem era, Sting would come out to Seek and Destroy. So that was quite strange to see that. I mean, I was taking my bathroom break when that was going on and you started bursting out laughing.
Yeah, because I had no idea that was used back for them.
Yeah, Sting used that back then, so that seeing it at the end, it put a smile on my face, but it also made me laugh at the same time. I thought they weren't going to pull that out, but a pretty decent coffin match despite the botches, but there was botches all night.
Yeah. So up next, we had Will Ospreay with Don Callis by his side against Chris Jericho with Sammy Guevara by his side.
Well, first, I will say I'm very happy. I'm kind of going backwards on here. Will Ospreay came out to his Sky Assassin theme, which is one of the best themes that ever came out of New Japan.
Yes.
But before that, Chris Jericho, if you're not familiar, has a hard rock heavy metal combo known as Fozzy. And
Waka Waka.
And they performed up to the first chorus of his theme song, which is also the Fozzy song, Judas.
Mm-hmm.
Of course, if you know anything about stadiums, the band was playing to a backing track, and Chris Jericho sounded very winded going up and down an elevator and doing all these things, so I think that was real.
Yeah.
They could have easily pre-recorded that where he did the same motion and they did things over, but I'm choosing to believe that was not the case.
Yeah, I think it was live.
But overall, I thought it was one of the better matches. I think that's because Will Ospreay pretty much carried the entire match.
Yeah, it was enjoyable for sure. Yeah, but yeah, Will is definitely the shining star of that one.
Yeah. And of course, Will Ospreay came out with the treasure known as Don Callis, part of the Don Callis family, which I'm still very curious to see what all that is going on with.
Absolutely.
Because is Bullet Club Gold a part of that? I mean, Takeshka is the only one that's formally a part of the Don Callis family right now, but he's working with Bullet Club Gold. He's working with Will Ospreay.
Yeah.
Is Ospreay going to join AEW?
Well, and that's the thing. Like, he seems to be representing so many people from New Japan right now. So, like, is he just going to be the New Japan representative? But we did both predict that Will Ospreay would win, and he did win.
Deservingly so.
Yeah. Up next, we had Billy Gunn and the Acclaimed, Anthony Bowens and Max Caster versus the House of Black, Malachi Black, Buddy Matthews, and Birdie King, of course, with Julia Hart by their side as well.
Who is from Bloomington, Minnesota, which is only one town over from us.
Yes.
Trios match. With the House of Black rules, for some reason, they're allowed to have like two different stipulations.
Yeah.
A part of it. I never really understood this whole thing they've been doing for the last few months. But it ended up basically being a no-holds-barred match, which basically is the same friggin' thing as the Stadium Stampede, which is the same thing as a hardcore match, which is the same thing as no disqualification.
Yes.
They're all the same thing.
Blue Steel.
Magnum.
Magnum.
Cobalt. It's all the same. But One thing of note, this wasn't the daddy ass Billy Gunn who retired a couple weeks ago. This goes all the way back to WWF Attitude Era. Badass Billy Gunn came out in what, well, it's not gonna be his last match, considering who won the match, but they sure made it seem like it was gonna be his final match.
Yeah.
But yeah, the Acclaimed with Billy Gunn scissored their way into being the Trios champions.
And we were both wrong with that one. Because we had guessed the House of Black.
And you found a new annoyance with the House of Black during this match.
Oh, yeah. Brody King. He does this, like, dog bark. And I know he does that on stage with his band as well. But
God's hate.
Yeah. It's just not my thing. Just not my thing.
Yeah, I'm assuming he's trying to be, like, a demon from hell, a dog from hell, Cerberus, or something like that.
It's just a little too bro-y for me.
Yeah. We're not bro. Although, as a straight white man, he is one of the most attractive men in AEW.
He is attractive. He is attractive.
Even if you found some things that you don't like about him, like God's hate, like the dog barking.
Yeah, yeah. But not my number one, though. Not my number one.
Of course, your number one is
Wheeler Yuta. Yeah.
Even with Ibushi showing up, it's still Wheeler.
Anyways,
final match here.
Main event, we had MJF versus Adam Cole.
And this was for the AEW World Championship.
Yes.
And if you were paying attention to the beginning of this, they fought in the very first match of the pre-show. This was the longest match. It went on for nearly a half hour, with all things considered. Every single spot gimmick that you can think of happened during this.
Yes.
Weapons, knocking the referee out, a double pin, which really made both of us mad.
Yes.
Until we realized that's not how it was gonna end.
No.
Possible betrayal.
We cried. Everything.
Everything was in this. But basically, it came down to a third wheel of this whole conversation. Roderick Strong coming out with his neck brace.
Yes.
And was telling Adam Cole to cheat to win.
Yes.
And it's funny because if you're watching AEW television, all this time you hear Roderick Strong say, "You can't trust MJF. He's going to betray you. He's going to hit you with something. He's going to do this and that." And then he's the one who's saying to do that.
Yes.
Basically a jealous boyfriend.
Essentially.
But all of that considered, shenanigans happen, and MJF does a quick roll-up, 1, 2, 3, and maintains being the AEW World Champion.
Yes.
But that's not the end of the story.
No, it's not. So it was a great match, I'll first say that, and I will say that I was right with this one. Josh was not. So after it's said and done, they're both kind of sitting in their quarters crying, and then MJF doesn't even care about the title. He drops the title and, like, crawls over to Adam Cole to give him, you know, some words of encouragement and tell him that people still love him even though he didn't win the match. And Adam, and then he gets out of the ring and grabs their tag team titles that they won earlier in the evening, and Adam's having none of that, so he throws the tag team title out of the ring, and everybody's like, oh no, what's going on, is he turning on him now? So then MJF takes offense to that and is like, was that what this was all about? You weren't really my friend, you were just using me to get a chance at the title. And then of course Roderick comes out again. As this is happening, MJF turns around, he's like, you know, just hit me with a championship right now, turns his back to him, and it gives him that chance. Roderick comes out and tries to talk Adam Cole into hitting him, and finally Adam Cole drops the title. MJF hears that, turns around, they embrace in the hug that we wanted all along.
And Roderick Strong leaves basically yelling and crying all the way out the entranceway.
Yes, and Adam's like, get out of here!
And it's very interesting with all of this happening, because what is going to happen next Sunday for All Out in Chicago? Which is funny because I have to bring this up now, because during the entire show, they decided to have a theme song. And of all the bands that you could think of that ever came from London or England or the UK or Europe, they decided on Bush with Machine Head.
Yes.
And all I can think of was Tony Khan was up late one night, and he just thought it would be so funny to change the lyrics to All In, All Out, All In, All Out, All In.
Yes. Yeah, it was a bit of a head scratcher, but what can you do?
So overall, I thought it was a good pay-per-view. I'm not...
Yeah.
It's far from the worst AEW pay-per-view that we've seen.
Absolutely.
And even the worst AEW pay-per-view is still miles above WWE.
Yes, that is true.
But I'm still very curious to see what's going to be happening next week at All Out.
Yeah.
Do you have any predictions for that ahead of time?
Well, we do know of 3 matches so far. So if we want to quick go through those, we can go through a particular them. First up, we have Miro versus Hobbs.
I'm just going to go Miro because why?
Yeah, there's no investment in this at all right now. Miro's just coming back, really. And why?
And Will Hobbs has turned into the Big Show. Like, one week he's a babyface, one week he's a heel, one week he's a babyface, one week he's a heel. It's just like, you never know what's going on. So where's the investment?
Exactly. So I will be going with Miro as well because I just like him more. So, and then the next one is Luchasaurus versus Darby.
Yes, and that is for the TNT Championship.
It is.
Now, the weird story that's going along here is Christian Cage is acting like he is the champion, the TNT Champion, while Luchasaurus is the actual champion.
Yeah.
It's a weird thing that's going on.
Yeah.
Although everything did tie in together with this coffin match, although it wasn't supposed to go this way because original partner of Swerve Strickland, A.R. Fox, had to bow out at the show in real life, so he got fired from Swerve Strickland's group, and there's a lot of backstage heat on him as well.
Mm-hmm.
But they fit in Christian Cage, which kind of makes you care a little bit more about the match next week.
Yeah.
Which was smart to do.
Yeah. So who are you going with?
I am still going to be going with Luchasaurus here, although the TNT title is really the Hot Potato Championship.
Absolutely.
Like, it every couple months there is a new champion, and it happens on TV. It doesn't happen on a pay-per-view, mm-hmm. which is another reason why I don't think that Darby will win, because the TNT Championship doesn't change hands on a pay-per-view. It changes hands on TV.
Okay.
So, yeah, I think that feud's going to be going a little bit longer.
And I am going Darby because it is a hot potato. And even though, like, Christian may be pretending he's a champion, Luchasaurus having the title, no, it's Darby.
And eventually, Luchasaurus is going to break away from Christian Cage because what a weird pairing all of that is. And also, I hope at some point, Tony Khan will do the right thing and buy the rights to Walk the Dinosaur, and Luchasaurus will be able to come onto that.
Yes.
It's what we all deserve.
It is. It is. And then finally, we have Chris Stanlander versus Ruby Soho for the BS title.
Yes. Apparently that title's been defended more on Collision, which is on TNT, which again is all the more confusing.
Yeah.
But I'm going to go with Statlander because she is the better champion. Ruby Soho pretty much lost all of her momentum when she joined up with Saraya and Tony Storm. And, you know, just I really see Chris Statlander being like the head of the women's division at some point. Maybe she's not there yet, even though she should be.
Mm-hmm.
I think she will be at the top at some point.
Yeah, I'm going to agree that Statlander is going to keep it. Like, she hasn't been champion for that long, especially considering the previous champion and how long she was in it. But the people have been wanting Statlander to be champion for so long, but she had so many injuries back after back, and this is finally her time, so I think she just needs to have her time to shine.
And that's all that's been announced so far, so we can't really go deeper. We can guess what's gonna happen, and hey, maybe even during this media scrum we're gonna find out that there was a match or two that got announced for All Out.
Right.
So we might not have done our due diligence for this podcast, so I apologize for that.
Yes.
If you are invested in this, but if you are a wrestling fan, if you are an AEW fan, what did you think of All In?
Yeah.
Let us know in the comments.
And what are you predicting for next week?
All right, so next up is normally movies, but we haven't sat down and watched a movie together this week due to a lot of stuff going on. Of course, again, Mole Man Studios, now up and running. Not looking its prettiest on my side yet, but that will change.
Yes.
But there is a little bit of TV news that we're looking forward to. Half looking forward to, half very depressed by.
Yes.
So why don't we start with the sad news first?
Yeah, so there will be no more seasons of WandaVision. It's pretty sad because I really, really enjoyed that series.
That was my favorite MCU TV show.
Absolutely, Adley.
I love how fourth wall it was, especially like how they made like a 50s sitcom in the very first episode.
Yeah.
It was the same length as a 50s sitcom.
Yes.
And every decade would like go through and they would make fun of all the sitcom tropes that were going on.
Yeah.
And then it started to actually affect the real MCU and all this stuff, and it tackled so much with mental health as well too.
Yeah, it was just such a good mix of like that superhero story along with humor and along with some really deep discovery too.
And of course everything that happened in WandaVision led into Doctor Strange and the Multiverse of Madness, where of course spoiler alert for a movie that if you cared about you would have seen it by now.
Yes.
Scarlet Witch turned heel and just went crazy.
Oof.
But I still love that movie. I love all the Sam Raimi-ness about all of it.
Yes.
I know a lot of people don't like it, but I like it because of that.
Yeah.
But the other news, I'm going in with lower expectations, but I think it'll still be enjoyable. The new season of Loki is coming out next month. Oh. Well, actually in October. It's still August right now, so.
Yeah.
First realized this from McDonald's, looking at their bags and seeing that Loki season 2 was going to be coming out.
Try the Loki sweet sour sauce now.
Hey, if it worked for Rick and Morty to bring Szechuan sauce, why not bring Loki into it?
It's true.
So how was that? That sweet and sour sauce.
It's a normal sweet and sour sauce. It's nothing special.
Just they didn't do anything different?
Now that I'm... I mean, I don't usually get sweet and sour sauce from there, but it tasted like sweet and sour sauce. So.
Okay. How do you feel about a season 2 with Loki?
I'm excited, kind of, but I guess I'm just curious where it's going to go.
Yeah. I am too, because especially if you've followed what's been happening with Jonathan Majors, also known as Kang, he's in a lot of hot water right now, so I'm very, very curious to see how things are going to be playing out from here on out.
Yeah.
Kang was supposed to be the big baddie of the second half of the MCU, obviously Thanos being the first half, and then Kang was going to be the second half, so yeah, some stuff's going on, and I don't really trust what's going to be happening in the future.
Yeah.
Then again, that also goes along with my Marvel fatigue, which I think we can cover in another show.
Yes.
Because if you thought death wasn't enough, if you thought positive rock and metal wasn't enough, if you thought All In wasn't enough, boy, we got some more, a lot of stuff to talk about when it comes into the video game world.
We sure do. So in the gaming world, we watched the kind of the intro to Gamescom 2023 earlier this week. Lots of new games coming out that were of interest to us.
Yeah, a lot of stuff that's been announced already and a lot of stuff that really caught me by surprise.
Absolutely. So just going kind of through some of these games. So obviously Starfield is coming out in just a couple weeks here.
Yeah, September 1st if you actually buy the game, or September 6th if you get it through Game Pass. It's probably the game I'm most looking forward to, being such a diehard Fallout fan and you being such a diehard Skyrim fan.
Yes.
This kind of meets right in the middle for both of us.
Exactly. I'm very, very curious about this. I think it'd be really fun if it does execute correctly.
Even if it does have the Bethesda jank to it, it still has its charm to me. I know a lot of people have... especially with Fallout 76, have gotten sick of it. For single-player games, I still think it's funny when it happens.
Absolutely. Next up, there was Rebel Moon.
Yes, Rebel Moon is not actually... Well, it will be a game.
Yes.
But Zack Snyder basically created his own Star Wars universe here. You know, just different enough.
Yeah.
But it still has lightsabers and stuff, which I can't believe they're getting away with. But it's going to be a two-part movie, one coming out in December, one coming out in April.
Yes.
And then in June, both movies will be combined with additional footage to create an over 5 hour long movie. So if you want non-Star Wars Star Wars, yes, and you can't get enough of it, that 5 hour director's cut will be for you.
Buckle up, Buttercup.
What is your thoughts on that?
I mean, I like Star Wars. I just have a hard time getting my mind around non-Star Wars Star Wars. I like my classic characters, you know? So, yeah, I'm not against watching it. I just am going in with some reservations.
Well, one thing that might help you out with it, in a lot of Zack Snyder movies, he does incorporate Richard Cheese in some way, shape, or form. So there could be, like, Richard Cheese doing the Katina Band theme or some kind of likeness to Star Wars.
That would be worth the price of admission right there.
Yeah, because, like, 28 Days Later, they had Down with the Sickness.
Yeah.
The one that came out a few years ago, they had Viva Las Vegas. I forgot. Army of the... Yeah, Army of the Dead.
Yeah.
So, you know, maybe for Rebel Moon, they can get the Katina Band together.
So up next, we got Little Nightmare 3.
Yes. So far, I've only played the first one, and I played its DLC, and it was a soul-crushing experience. It looks very cute. It's kind of got, like, almost like this claymation kind of feel behind it.
Yeah.
It's made from a European game developer, and it's kind of got those kind of European charms to it.
Mm-hmm.
The DLC crushed my soul for everything that happened in it, and...
Yeah.
Actually made me weep.
Yeah.
Little Nightmares 2 is a prequel, which I haven't played yet, but we really should. And
absolutely.
It's a horror game, so maybe we can do that with the stuff that's going to be going on for the next few weeks.
Yeah.
Wink, wink, nudge, nudge.
We'll get into that in our looking forward to section.
Yes. But the third one does look like it's going to be a sequel, and it looks like it could be played co-op. And now that we have two PlayStation 5 controllers and the screen doesn't shake for a game like that, you might be able to actually play it.
We could.
Yeah, what do you think?
Yeah, I mean, I haven't played it myself, but I've obviously watched you play the first one, and it's weird because it's so cute because they're just little, but it's so depressing too. So it's kind of hard wrapping your mind around it, but it's a great game.
Oh, absolutely. Great series.
Up next, we have Assassin's Creed Mirage.
Yes. Apparently, this is a very scaled down version of Assassin's Creed, especially with games like Origins, Odyssey, and Valhalla. The games were absolutely super massive in their maps, and this one's going to be scaled back a bit. I don't know how big it's going to be, but it's going to be more along the lines of the original games, which are still pretty decent sized maps, all considered. But it's going to be focusing on the Iraq area. It definitely seems like a very intriguing premise with the way everything's going, and it's actually one that kind of got your attention a little bit too with its setting.
Yeah, I love games and stuff based around that setting, and it just looked really amazing. So yeah, I'm excited to see you play it and maybe play it myself.
Yeah. And it's not a full price game. It's not a $70 game either. That's I think it's like $50. So.
Up next, we have Tekken 8.
Yes. I wanted to bring this one up because, as I mentioned on the birthday show, I played for like an hour Tekken Tag Tournament while you were playing Double Bubble.
Yes.
And we both played on the original Japanese arcade machines for both of those.
Yeah.
That was a really cool experience.
It was. It was fun.
I hadn't played Tekken Tag Tournament since I was a little kid. I never had the game, but I had the demo disc.
Nice.
And I played the crap out of that as much as I could. And I, of course, played it in the arcades as well.
Yeah.
So that was fun. But Tekken 8, of course, being the eighth, well, actually ninth if you take away tag tournament, if you include tag tournament. I'm excited about the characters that they have. It's a little more advanced than Mortal Kombat. It's a little more strategic. Of course, my biggest problem with all of this is you don't get everything in one, even if you get the full-on deluxe gold super ultimate edition.
Yeah.
You don't get everything. And that's my problem with a game that we're going to be talking about in a very similar vein on this list, where I just want the game. I want the characters. I want all of it. So if I want to play this, I'm going to have to wait a year or two until they finally are done with all of the content and I can just buy it at once.
Yeah, if you're buying a special edition, you should get all that content. Even if it's not out yet, like as it comes out, you'd be getting that.
Thank you.
Up next, we have Fort Solace.
Yes, this was one that I really didn't know a lot about, but it seemed very, very intriguing to me. It's a brand new horror game. Voice actor Troy Baker, who probably is best known as being Joel from The Last of Us, of course, amongst all the other work that he's done, but it seems like it's a star-studded voiceover cast in this really intriguing horror game. And that's about all that I could really pick up from it.
Yeah.
But I really like the way it looked, and it looked very intriguing to me.
Yeah, I'm intrigued by it for sure. Up next, Cyberpunk.
Yes, Cyberpunk Phantom Liberty.
Yes.
Not only just a new addition to Cyberpunk, like an add-on, not necessarily DLC, although it can be looked at as DLC.
Yeah.
You know, it's kind of like when you do like D&D and you add like a brand new story to it and everything. It's kind of like that. But not only are they doing a brand new story and they're incorporating stuff with that, but they basically revisioned the whole game, which is what got my attention. There was a lot of jank in the beginning. I constantly had my PS4 crash as I was playing it. On the PS5, with the updates that they've done for like PS5 version, it's awesome. But what they're going to be doing with this is it's basically Cyberpunk 2.0, where there's going to be a whole lot of new stats, a whole lot of new features, a whole lot more things that you can do with it. There's going to be a brand new area that wasn't in the game originally.
Mm-hmm.
It's the game that should have came out back in 2023.
Yeah.
And a lot of those updates are actually for free. And then Phantom Liberty is only $35, and the story is about as long as the main story of the game.
Nice.
So that ain't not bad.
It ain't not bad. Up next, Mortal Kombat.
Yes, Mortal Kombat 1. And this is the one I was specifically talking about, where I hate that you can't get all the characters at once.
Yes.
I love what they're doing with the bonus characters this time around. They have Homelander from The Boys.
Yes.
They have Omni-Man from Invincible. They have Peacemaker from Peacemaker and the Justice League. And not Justice League. What's wrong with me? It's Suicide Squad.
Yes.
There's more characters I saw too. I think I saw like Quan Chi is going to be a part of that and some other Mortal Kombat characters. Yeah. Problem is, even if you get like the Ultimate Deluxe Edition or whatever it's called, that's just season one.
Yes.
And they're doing more than one season. So you're going to have to buy an additional season if you want to be able to get everything.
Ugh, that's ridiculous.
And I'm so intrigued by it because they basically rebooted the series where Liu Kang basically took over Raiden's role of like God of Earth and everything's kind of changed. And one of the biggest things, of course, is Johnny Cage is now voiced by Jean-Claude Van Damme.
Yes.
Who was the original inspiration for Johnny Cage for the original Mortal Kombat. They finally got him for Mortal Kombat 1. I want to play it so bad, but I'm going to have to wait till like 2025 until all this stuff comes out.
Basically.
Which breaks my heart.
Yeah.
And we have so much... One of the things that we love to do, like there's a video game store that we used to go to, although we haven't gone to there in a while. And yeah. Also Starcade, like I talked about during the birthday show. We love playing Mortal Kombat against each other.
Yes.
She always picks Sub-Zero. Although she might switch it out once in a while. I always start with Jax, who is always my first guy to start with.
Yes.
And we always play each other, whether it's Mortal Kombat 2, 3, 4, whatever.
Yes.
Or any of the new games on the PlayStation. She always picks Sub-Zero, I always pick Jax, and we have such a fun time killing each other.
Absolutely. I'm better than you at that.
Yeah. And I want to play Mortal Kombat 1 when that happens.
Yes.
But I just hate that we're going to have to wait because I don't want to spend like $300 whatever it's going to cost.
It's just ridiculous. And then another one that we have talked about in the past, Alan Wake 2.
Alan Wake 2 is definitely one I'm really looking forward to. This one is going to be more of a survival horror one, kind of like for you, it'd be kind of like Resident Evil 2 in a sense.
Yeah.
Where you're not going to have all the ammunition that you need necessarily. And you're going to be trapped in a lot of spaces, and the ones that you have to kill are going to be much, much harder to kill.
Yeah.
Whereas in the original Alan Wake, all you needed was your flashlight to shine on these demon creatures and they would dissipate.
Mm.
This time you actually have to kill them.
Oof.
And it takes place between the world that Alan Wake is trapped in from the end of the first game and a brand new character in the real world. And it goes between both of them. I love the Alan Wake game. It turned me onto Poets of the Fall, which is one of Finland's greatest underrated bands in America.
Yeah.
They pimp them out so hard, that studio does. Like, every single game that they put out, there is a Poets of the Fall song in there. And I'm hoping that's the case with Alan Wake, too.
Hopefully so.
So what did you think of Alan Wake from what you saw?
Yeah, I mean, I never played the original, but I'm definitely curious for how it goes. I mean, it sounds like it's a bit different from the first one, but... Well.
And also, it got moved back a week to, I believe, October 27th. So it's perfect. Right in line with Halloween. Yes.
So, not from Gamescom, but we did hear about new handheld PlayStation.
Yes, the PlayStation Portal coming in at $200, and this is a disappointment.
It really is.
So, there's no Bluetooth.
No.
So, you cannot connect it to your PS5 that way.
No.
You can do Wi-Fi, but not Bluetooth.
Yes.
The brand new Bluetooth headphones that you got for your phone and stuff, you can't use it with the portable.
No.
You can't stream PS5 or PS4 games on it. In fact, you can only play games that are on the hard drive of your PS5, which defeats the purpose of the portable PlayStation Point.
Yep.
The one upside is that it's $200.
Yes.
Where a lot of people thought it was going to be anywhere from $300 to $400.
Yes.
So coming in at $200 is better, but it's $200 for something that you still don't want.
Exactly.
And as someone who was very interested in the original idea of this, how does that make you feel?
It's disappointing. I mean, it's like the price is right, but then you realize it's for nothing, so...
So, yeah, maybe we can get you into, like, a handheld or something of a different kind. Or, I heard Amazon Fire Stick you can play Game Pass on. If there's any truth of that, please let me know in the comments if that's true.
That could be a novel. So, going off that a little bit, so you've been playing WrestleQuest.
Yes, I finally picked that up on Tuesday at $30, which, for how long the game is a miraculous price for it. I've thoroughly enjoyed it so far.
Yeah.
I know there's some problems with it that I completely and utterly understand. The map on the game sucks. It doesn't tell you if you're going left, right, up, down, anything.
Yeah.
And I don't mean the map where you see the little character going across.
Yeah.
I mean like the little circle map
on
there. You have no idea where you are.
Okay.
So I understand that problem completely.
Yes.
Some people have a problem with how they think it's just about one character, but it turns out to be about two characters, and it's two stories going on back and forth.
Yeah.
One is about the Muchacho Man, which of course is inspired by Macho Man Randy Savage. In the game, it shows how inspired he is. Yeah. And then the second story is about the Logan family, which is inspired by the Hart family. Mm-hmm. In fact, your favorite character, Stag Logan, is in there, who is a literal moose.
Yes. with a hockey stick.
With a hockey stick. Loves hockey, loves wrestling. And his finisher is the antler bomb. It's a turn-based game, which can turn off some people. I've actually gotten really used to it in here, and I don't have a problem with it in this game.
Yeah.
I can see how it's monotonous for some people, but I love getting lost in games because it helps me get out of the real world when I need to. So doing something like this, I don't have a problem with. And I just love exploring what each situation is going to include because, you know, like they showed the Macho Man, they showed Legion of Doom, they showed Sergeant Slaughter, they show all the Nasty Boys. And there's so many more that I haven't even gotten to yet.
Yeah.
From you watching me play, what did you think?
Yeah, it seemed fun. Definitely kind of cutesy animations, which I think it's good for me because I like that. But it has a lot of humor in it too. And a lot of, like, if you're into wrestling and grew up watching wrestling, like, it's a lot of callback to that. So it's just kind of fun seeing a lot of that stuff.
And it is $30 on PlayStation. I think it's on Xbox as well and PC, Switch. But if you have Netflix, it's for free on your phone.
Yes.
And I can't get you to play it, even though it's free, and all you have to do is download it.
At some point, I might.
I think you should. I think you would have a lot of fun with it. But we'll see what happens with that. But yeah, that's a lot of game coverage going on here.
So on my end, I do have a couple things. So Love Island the game wrapped up this week.
Oh, it wrapped up.
It did. So I ended up with, I stuck with my Roberto, and we are official now.
Ooh.
Just so you know. But of course, our twin and her man that she's been dating for 2 days became official first, because they were the first ones to become official. Also, like, within the last, like, few episodes, like, you had, like, 3 different chances to spend alone time with him, wink wink, but you couldn't do any of them without spending 29 credits, so we didn't get any alone time with our person. And, like, especially, like, depending on who you chose throughout the season to end up with in the end, you might not have had any alone time with him at all, ever. It was all about, like, girl talk and stuff like that. You never got to, like, actually know the person you were dating. Like, it was ridiculous. Granted, I'm gonna replay it many times, kind of play the different paths, just because that's who I am, but that was that.
That's what happens when you play microtransaction games.
I know. And then Too Hot to Handle, another season, or not season, but episode that came out this week. I have a couple different playthroughs I'm doing at the same time. One where I'm remaining loyal to Antoine, and then another one where I'm...
Antoine Bugle Boy?
Yes. And then another one where I'm kind of interested in Ryder, who's kind of the hard-to-get guy. So he's kind of stringing me and one other girl along, but he's really after me, going to her because he's afraid of. So we're going to get there, though. We're going to get there with Ryder.
A dagger through my heart. I'm sorry I can't stand up to Roberto and Ryder and...
Oh, it's okay. And that concludes our gaming content.
So up next, it's time to get back into the newer music side of things. Of course, you checked out some stuff, but I, of course, have to do the heavy-duty Judy work of what I do every month and cover my top 10 favorite albums of August 2023.
Yes.
And this month had some stuff that you enjoyed, some stuff you didn't enjoy, but we'll get there as we talk about things.
Yeah.
First off is good friends of mine, Aeonic Impulse, with Beyond the Light, their sophomore album of the more dark, depressing, progressive metal side. Although they started incorporating some more alternative metal stuff this time around. There's some actual screams for the first time in the band. Earlier this year, they did a cover of The Cure's Love Song, which features a family friend of mine, Alicia Mitchell, on vocals. I thoroughly enjoy this thing, and if you are looking for some dark prog, I think it's a really good route to go down.
Yeah.
Next up is Syra with the Vertigo Trigger. This is the third album from this band, featuring ex-members of In Flames and Amaranth and the current drummer of Camelot, amongst other great members of the band. I feel like the band finally found themselves on this album, like I've mentioned a few times on the show so far, talking about this album. It's that perfect mixture of hard rock and heavy heavy metal combined. It's almost mellow death with all clean vocals. It's almost too metal for hard rock, but I feel like it'd be so perfect for top 40 rock radio if top 40 rock radio was in a better place.
Yes.
Well, since you actually know this one, what's your thoughts on Syrah?
Yeah, I'm really liking it too, and I know I've talked about this in the previous episodes as well, but I love what they're doing now. I've loved their previous work well, but this one is just really fine-tuned in on kind of where they're going, I think.
Yeah, definitely a great way to look at it. Next up, we got Ex Mortis with Necrophine. Or, not Necrophine. Necrophony. It's like Necro Symphony combined. Necrophine. Sorry, I'm terrible.
Necrophony.
How did I get it right in the YouTube video, but I did not get it right now? I said it right in the video. But anyways,
however you want to pronounce it.
Yeah, however you want to pronounce it. There's so many different ways you can pronounce this. Ex Mortis, Ex Mortis, whatever you want to say. but anyways, the band's fifth album, it's probably their most brutal album that they've put out to date. It still absolutely covers the neoclassical Yngwie, if he did, melodic death and thrash style that I love about them.
Yes.
But there's a lot more blast beats. There's a lot more heaviness that's going on with it. But they do it with still that great majestic sound that they have, where the melodies and harmonies just really shine through at the same time.
Absolutely. Yeah, I mean, you got it on the nail on the head. Like, it's that classic mortar sound just amped up a little bit.
Yeah. And, you know, it's great to see that even with half the band leaving since the last album, I'm glad that they were able to pull that off.
Absolutely.
Next up, we have the legendary Dundalind on TikTok, Dundalind on TikTok, Dundalind on TikTok, Dundalind on TikTok, Death Clock, Death Clock, Death Clock, Death Clock, with Death Album 4. Yes, I was doing the opening and doing it badly enough so this won't get copyright stricken.
Yes.
With easily my favorite Death Clock album. It might not have the most famous songs that they'll have. I know a lot of people find Death Clock to be passé at this point, like they're over Death Clock, and you know, it's like, oh, I watched that as a kid, but I don't care about it anymore, and it's so weird to think about that was nearly 20 years ago.
Oh,
so, yeah, let's try not to think about that. But this particular album, it might be the final album from Death Clock. I'm not entirely sure how everything's going to be going, and with the writer's strike and everything, we really won't have any answers for quite a bit of time.
Mm-hmm.
But I do know with this particular album, when they focus on the melodies and harmonies, they shine through so well. When they focus on the brutality, it's there. And they have such great funny moments in there as well too, which is really tongue-in-cheek and not just like comedy skits like happen on other albums. You have to listen for the funny, and it's worth it when you pay for it.
Yeah.
But this is one, like, I really don't even know how you feel about Death Clock.
I will say I love Metalocalypse. I love Metalocalypse, especially Tokyo Warp. If I was a cartoon,
not a bumblebee.
No, if I was a cartoon, I would marry him. But Death Clock, I've just never really gotten into.
Well, you heard it next. What's your problem will be Death Clock. that is unfortunate to hear. Continuing on with death metal, we got Horrendous with Ontological Mysterium. Funny how I can say that perfectly, but I couldn't say Necrophony.
Yes.
Right, I can't even do it now. It's probably all the pain that I'm in from moving.
Probably.
But Ontological Mysterium from Horrendous is easily the band's best album. Really covers the 90s progressive death metal sound of death, cynic, atheist, pestilence. Even little moments of Edge of Sanity in there too, which I really appreciate. And for the first time ever with a Horrendous album, I actually like the production. It doesn't sound like it was just recorded in a basement with a 4-track recorder. It actually sounds like they went into the studio and made an album in 2023, which it is 2023. You don't have an excuse to have crappy sounding demos anymore.
Yeah.
There's so many free programs that you can get on the computer and get the same sounds out of.
Yes.
This is another one that I knew was not up your alley.
No.
Even with the Edge of Sanity stuff going on there. Anyways, for one that you did enjoy is the brand new album from Novaria with The Gates of the Underworld. And you would think with a title like that, it would be like melodic death metal or black metal or something like that. You would be wrong.
Yeah.
It is progressive power metal in the vein of Symphony X and Pagan's Mind and DGM. And they started to incorporate a little bit more of the modern metal, like down-tuning 8-string guitars a little bit. So if you like that modern metal, almost djent kind of sound, that is an underbelly, but it is not the main core sound of the album.
Yeah, because if it was, I wouldn't like it.
Exactly. Take it from someone who hates djent.
Yes.
But this one captured you pretty much immediately.
Yeah, it's extremely catchy. Like you said, power pog mix, which is right up my alley. Yeah, some beautiful stuff going on there.
Yeah, definitely. And hopefully you'll be able to check out more of the album, because this album definitely has a lot of that Symphony X feel that you love.
Yes.
From the band. Next up is Orbit Culture with Descent. This band skyrocketed in YouTube, TikTok, social media. And I was familiar with them only because they were supposed to be playing this year's Prog Power, but they dropped out to be on a bigger European tour. Might have been the right choice for the band, because they have kind of skyrocketed in popularity, like I said, and all of the metal channels are going ape-poopy all over this band. They combine mellow death, progressive metal, symphonic metal, all these different things, and it's super catchy. As well. Yeah. Like the standout song, the main single from the album, From the Inside, is just like, has a really nice dancey, catchy beat behind it. Super catchy chorus.
Yeah.
It's got strings in the right part. It gets super heavy in the right spots. And even for someone who doesn't like when bands go all over the place, you do like what's going on here with Orbit Culture.
Yeah. It's a very unique mix, but it's still cohesive, which I like.
Yes. She does not like the uncohesive stuff.
No.
Which I understand. I understand.
Yeah.
No need to go into the modeling of the well stuff again. I understand. But
nope.
But the Orbit Culture seemed like it's up there. But for more stuff that you did not enjoy, which we already touched on earlier, is the new album from Ringworm, Seeing Through Fire. Like I mentioned in the top 10 positive songs or motivational songs, however you want to look at it, however you want to pronounce it, I find Ringworm to be my angry band when I just need to unleash all the aggression that I have. Every one of their albums is short enough, sweet enough, and has the intensity that I need to be able to get through some of the most frustrating things that I have to go through. And I can just sit on the couch and enjoy it. So I don't have to be in the pit and beat up punk teenagers. I can just enjoy it and let that anger flow through in the music.
Yes.
And as we mentioned, you do not like it.
No.
Next up, we have Tegmentum with Evolvement, a brand new debut album from past and present members of Fallujah and Worm Ouroboros and many other bands. This is a combination of very atmospheric metal and progressive death metal, and this sings right to me. I love when you can make prog interesting, and I love when you add ethereal, atmospheric moments in the right spots. And when the clean vocals hit at the right spots, it's awe-inspiring. When they go into the more technical stuff, it fits, and it's not just wankery. I love this album. You were him hawing it. I remember you said you liked parts of it, but other parts you did not like.
Yeah, yeah.
And then finally, another one that is the exact same thing for you as well. You said the exact same thing. The band Urn with their sophomore album, A Feast on Sorrow. This is another qualifier for one of the saddest albums of the year. This one especially hits home, as I've lost many people in my family to dementia. And this is an album about either being in the position of watching your body slowly decay over the years, specifically your mind if you get dementia. Also from the part of seeing others go through it and the pain that goes along with that. It's a very, very dark album. Joe from Gorgira actually found out about Urn with their past album and invited them into his New York studio to record this album, which is why the album sounds so pristine on production. But if you're looking for a dark metal album that can go from like sludge to hardcore to progressive to more to nevermore riffs, like it goes into so many different places, but I feel like it's all cohesive and you just want to be a sad little F-boy like me, you should check out the new album from Urn.
Yes.
And yeah, like I said, you were him hawing this one as well. Like moments you enjoyed, moments you didn't enjoy.
Yeah, pretty much.
And that was my top 10. If you want to know a little bit deeper about all of that, I cover that in the YouTube video for the top 10 albums of August 2023 and in written form on heavydebriefings.weebly.com. And I'm going to have you cover these last couple albums that we checked out together. And yeah, they're definitely albums that we checked out over the past week. Take it away.
Well, I'll start with a higher note. So I think I brought it up in the last, but maybe the one before, that we somehow missed the Winger album coming out earlier this year. Yeah. And we did listen to a couple of singles at the time and really enjoyed those. And we finally listened to the rest of the album. Yeah, I like it. I mean, I felt like the one of the singles in particular was definitely the strongest number from it, but it's still some good stuff on there. And I think it's worth a listen for sure. On the flip side. Oh, well, yeah, go for it.
Yeah. I, of course, am not as big of a Winger fan as the Metal Faerie or Stewart is, but I really did enjoy the album from start to finish. There was a couple cliche moments, but I think that's gonna happen with a band like Winger. That's unavoidable.
Yes,
but it's nothing in compared to the next album that we'll be talking about. But if you're looking for like that classic glam rock, really sophisticated hard rock,
yes,
Winger 7 is a great choice for 2023.
Absolutely.
And in the polar opposite,
yeah, so I had brought up previously that I checked out a couple singles from Hurricane that was out coming out with a new album, and you know, I was okay with the singles. They were okay, but we checked out the rest of the album and didn't make it through the entire thing even, because it was just oof, it was quite lackluster. They even did a cover of their own song with a different singer, and it's just oof, it's not good.
You also forgot that's not the only cover on the album. They covered Queen and David Bowie Under Pressure as well.
I forgot about that too. Yeah. And added nothing to it. I mean, I don't like the song to begin with, but.
Well, you don't like Queen or David Bowie to begin with.
No, I don't.
But yeah, just. And the other songs, like the first song was the only one that I kind of enjoyed because it kind of had like a sleazy kind of feel behind it.
Yeah.
The rest of the songs were just not for us.
No.
That was really disappointing because I enjoy Hurricane.
Yes. Well, yeah, I feel like Hurricane, their work from back in the day, is one of the most underappreciated bands out of the 80s.
So, all of that said, if I remember from last week's show, you owe me an apology.
I do not.
You do, actually.
It's still the band Hurricane.
It is not Hurricane.
They go by Hurricane, therefore
if Kelly
Hurricane.
Is not singing in the band, they're not putting out quality music. And if they're not putting out quality music, it's not Hurricane.
Hashtag not your hurricane.
Not my hurricane. So we're pretty much at the end of the show now.
Yeah.
So we covered a lot of ground here.
We did.
Death, life, wrestling, and everything in between.
Absolutely.
What are you looking forward to coming up?
Well, what I'm really looking forward to is, as we drape into September here, we are going to take Halloween and explode it to a 2-month event.
Ooh.
Yes. So as you've gathered, I'm really into horror and Halloween and everything of the kind. So for the shows for all of September and October, we'll have a little Halloween specialness speckled through all of them.
Yes, the Heavy Debriefing Spooktacular.
Exactly.
Yeah, we're going to be doing top tens that cover horror stuff, not necessarily just music.
Nope.
We might be doing other horror things, comparing slasher icons or
Absolutely.
Horror icons, different movies, maybe recommendations for people,
yeah.
Things that we're looking forward to in the future. You know, there's so many different things that we could be covering, Ooh. And I'm excited for where we're gonna go with that.
Yeah, we'll also be taking in a lot of Halloween and fall content, music, movies, TV, all that stuff. We'll also probably take current fall activities too, maybe kind of give some recommendations for those in the area.
Although I will say we're not really the pumpkin spice type, so if you're looking for that, you might have to find another show.
Yeah, I like pumpkin-y foods, just a drink. Ugh.
And I've never been a fan of pumpkins to begin with.
Yes.
But yeah, I'm definitely looking forward to that. I know you're pretty much gonna be leading the charge for a lot of that. I know you've already began a lot with that, and I'm very excited to see what you're going to be doing for the show with the Halloween content. And I think with that, I think that's a great spot to end. And I thank you very much for sticking around for the show. Of course, let us know what you think of the show on social media, all under Heavy Debriefings, with Facebook, Instagram, Threads, YouTube. There's the website, of course, heavydebriefings.weebly.com, because I'm not spending hundreds upon hundreds of dollars for the name for that anymore, as that's not worth it. Of course, check out the show anywhere that you check out podcasts. I mean, Spotify, Apple, Google, YouTube. Of course, we have the YouTube playlist, which covers the podcast as well. Everywhere you want to check it out, the only excuse is that you don't want to listen to it.
Exactly.
Yeah. Well, again, thank you for tuning in for the 7th episode. I can't believe we've made it this long.
Woo!
Number 8 begins the spooktacular. we'll probably come up with a better name than that. I just wanted to do that.
Yeah.
And you'll be hearing some of my Halloween impressions over the years. I do have a Crypt Keeper voice. I do have some other ones as well that I will sprinkle in.
Absolutely.
At times. But until those bloody times, for the Metal Faerie, this is Josh Rundquist for the Heavy Debriefings podcast saying, see ya.